Dear viewers, we welcome you to Urban TV. The program is The National Agenda. We always bring you this program every Monday. And today in the studio, we have so many resourceful panelists. On my immediate left is Lieutenant Colonel Doe Akiki, who is the Deputy UPDF spokesperson. And next to him is Charity Ahimbisiwe from SEDU. Charity, you are welcome.
Thank you very much, Moses.
Next to her is Henry Muguzi from the Alliance for Finance Monitoring.
Thank you, Moses.
We continue to look at the ongoing activities regarding the general elections 2021. Campaigns have already kicked off. So many events are unfolding. Some are very shocking, like the brutality that we've witnessed against opposition presidential candidates, especially the NUPU candidate Robert Kyagulanyi and the FDC presidential candidate Amuriat. And we've not seen this happening to the NRM. Of course, the argument given by the security forces is that these people are not complying with the guidelines that were given by the Electoral Commission. But of course, in the recent few days, we've also seen the NRM camp also having similar processions, and especially spearheaded by Bebe Cool and other people who are mobilizing wherever the president is going. And not only that, by the way, but we've also seen a number of NRM parliamentary candidates holding big processions and rallies in their constituencies. And it looks like, by the way, some of these guidelines may not be practical, because you cannot expect that you can have general elections without people congregating. At least in all the other countries where general elections have been happening, we've been seeing gatherings. Let me start with you, Afande Akik. In the previous general elections, we never used to see UPDF getting involved in campaigns. At least on the polling day, yes, we remember they used to be involved, because the argument was that the police officers were not enough to man all the polling stations. Why are we seeing UPDF getting involved this time in the campaigns, especially when it comes to the FDC and the NUPU presidential candidates?
First of all, I want to correct that impression that it is not correct that UPDF was not seen. UPDF was there, but depending on the magnitude of the violence that comes with our elections. Even in the past elections, we have seen that every time we have elections, the level of violence, the level of flouting the rules of the game keep increasing. And of course, the enthusiasm of Ugandans also keep increasing. So the elections of 2011, 2016, 2020 now, they cannot be the same. And for us, our involvement depends on the call on we get from the Uganda Police Force. We come in to give support to Uganda Police. So it is up to Uganda Police capacity to handle certain level of violence that will determine how many soldiers will come. You know, I have always talked about this issue of, how do you call it, the force which is, they call it which force? You use certain force, minimum force.
Mm. Minimum force
depends on how much minimum force the other opponent has come with. If you came with two pangas.
So you look at opposition as opponents?
I don't want to look at opposition or the ruling government. I'm looking at objectively at security. So when you come with two pangas, I will get three much more than yours. It is a principle, it is a military principle. If you are one soldier, But if you are one civilian, I'm supposed to bring three soldiers to deal with you. So the magnitude, the number of people coming up into being violent, the number of activities that we are seeing going towards putting this country to anarchy is the more UPDF you will see. And that will that means the number of people involved in violent activities are much bigger than the police. Then we have to get, they have to call a much bigger number of UPDF to give them support. And this does not matter whether it is opposition or NRM. I have been, actually when I was coming, I was watching news on one of the on the TV stations. I saw all people of all colors being tear gassed. I didn't mark different places. I was just watching. I saw yellow, I saw blue, I saw red everywhere. I wouldn't want to associate myself with the opposition or NRM. Then two, we must, it is very clear. We have groups that have certain categories that have completely refused to comply with the rules as put up by the Electoral Commission and also the guidelines against COVID-19. You may totally be blind not to see that.
But the concern is on selective application.
So
we have not seen a combined force of UPDF and the police
to me,
dispersing NRM supporters. We keep
for
seeing.
For example, I'm not going to mention parties, but I had one of the leaders who openly said that I will go against the rules.
Because
when you say that, the police also will say, we shall not accept you to go against the rules. And that's where the violence starts from, to me. However, we have seen that I think the level we are at now, the Electoral Commission, at some point will have to come out very clear on what course of action. Not necessarily we only in the uniform. Because yes, will tear gas until tear gas gets finished. But
okay,
the Electoral Commission is the big player in this.
We shall get back to you.
At some point it has to come out.
Mr. Mguz, what is your take on what is happening, especially the confrontations between the opposition presidential candidates and the combined force of the police and the army? It's as if we are in war.
I think from the perspective of the ordinary man, and I being one of them, it would seem that whereas for us, we perceive of the election as this peaceful exercise that would allow people to come out and assemble and be able to exercise their right as citizens to vote. For the men in uniform, I think it goes beyond that. I think that for them it's much more like a military expedition. And therefore, the kind of force they come down with to deal with the stubborn opposition supporters and leaders is as if they are dealing with criminals. But that said, I think the high-handedness that Ugandans have been seeing over time that gets to be applied on people, on politicians that come from other parties, the opposition, to say the least, is rather concerning. And if we want to grow our democracy, I think it's important that the men in uniform understand that they have a duty actually to make sure that they help us to put in place a semblance of a free and fair election that allows a period that can allow, you can call it a period of grace that can allow all candidates that have been successfully nominated to converse freely. Because for me, I'm a football supporter. I don't, and the reason I support Barcelona, for instance, is because we want to win beautiful football. Even when I'm powerful, I don't want to win ugly. I think it's important that whoever gets to win does win beautifully. But these ugly scenes we get to see kind of spoiling the soup and muddying up the waters in a way and manner that gets to impact negatively on the feelings of future loving Ugandans.
Charity, what is your take on these confrontations that have become a daily happening?
I think one of the things that is sad is that despite having told the police on a continuous basis that we want peace, not war, not bloodshed, not violence, it has stayed the same. There are very many trigger-happy policemen. I even wonder what makes them trigger-happy. I wonder what makes them so excited about tear gas and seeing their fellow citizens grappling for breath, struggling with pain. I really wonder if they have a heart inside of them, because you see, we have been fronting for what we call a human rights-based approach, and they know it as the police. Guidelines have been issued, and they want to use the excuse of the Electoral Commission guidelines. I like what Afande Deo Akiki here said, that the Electoral Commission will now have to come out very strongly to put its foot down as the arbiter in this electoral process. The Constitution in Article 60 says the Electoral Commission is supposed to manage and administer elections. Yes, they put out guidelines, but part of the guidelines that they put out in the Presidential Elections Act, Section 24(1), they said that they will be able to provide airtime for all the 11 presidential candidates on UBC.
Is it happening?
And it will be equal airtime for all. It hasn't happened. Now, they don't have airtime on TV yet, and in 14 days after nomination, UBC was required to write to them and indicate the slots and the time when they can afford to go to the station and present their manifestos to the citizenry. Honestly, you cannot have an election where presidential candidates cannot speak out to the citizens who are going to vote for them. Then what is that? Is that an election? If you cannot allow people to express themselves, then what are you doing? So I think that the police either doesn't understand that it is an election, they think it is just an act, or they were wrongly briefed. Somebody somewhere is not telling us, there's a missing gap somewhere. Because in an electoral process, the police also knows their duty is only one: protect life and property and prevent violent circumstances from happening, but not prevent opposition from engaging with the citizenry. Now the way it looks like, it is like prevent opposition from engaging with the citizenry. Because when you look at all the tear gas that has been spread, it is prevent opposition from engaging with the citizenry, which I find very, very unfortunate. Because everybody is supposed to reach out to the citizen, present their agenda to the ordinary citizen, and the citizen decides. So they could use media, was given to them, door-to-door kakuyege was given to them, border borders was given to them, 200 people in a venue that is agreed and you're socially distanced, and make sure that COVID-19 SOPs are in place, was given to them by the Electoral Commission. Every candidate was told, you're free to go ahead and have more than one or five meetings, including getting your party agent to sit in some of the meetings for you. Now, what the Electoral Commission was clear about was the question of processions and rallies. The Electoral Commission said no one will be allowed to hold rallies or processions. Unfortunately, the other legal instruments that still exist talk about processions and rallies. But the Electoral Commission, where it was coming from, was the situation of COVID-19. And where we are all stakeholders in an electoral process, that we agree that, yes, let's move consciously. I think there should also be a kind of effort from the opposition in terms of showing that we know we are in a COVID election, and people should wear their masks, people should have sanitizers, because COVID is real, it is killing people. I've remembered and even put back my mask.
But Charlotte, as you continue, practically speaking, I don't think you can have elections happening without having some processions. You remember even in the NRM primaries, including ministers, they were having processions. So some of these things, in as much, you see, just like you remember when the president was lifting a number of sectors out of the COVID lockdown, there are some guidelines that were given which were not practical. Like you remember the requirement for a border person to carry a book and register. Some of these guidelines that have been given by the Electoral Commission, it looks like they didn't consult widely. Some of them don't seem to be practical, especially when you're having general elections. What do you think?
Now, of course, some of the guidelines are impracticable. That's true. But it is also true that the Electoral Commission called stakeholders and they had discussions over these guidelines. What I had expected was that the people who had been called to these meetings would have objected to the unconstitutional guidelines, or the guidelines that were not going to allow them to enjoy their constitutional right. They were supposed to have rejected those. But when they didn't, they seemed to give Electoral Commission the leeway to implement them the way they are. Now, on Monday, which is today, there was a stakeholders meeting that happened at Electoral Commission. I've been asking Mr. Kenya to give us an update as a country on what happened, because most of the candidates did not show up, but they sent their agents to go and sit in that meeting. But what I've heard from the DP presidential candidate, they discussed some of those guidelines and agreed that more spaces for engagement must be agreed to, which I also agree. Yes, we need more spaces for engagement, but they must be safe. They must be safe, because we said COVID is real. And Moses, it is unfortunate that we are dealing with a difficult election, that the police is only making more difficult. Me, I wish the police would understand to try and make it easier for Ugandan, not just to fire the tear gas for the sake of it. Just understand that, okay, they are also trying to engage with the candidate, but there is COVID. So suppose we just put a water cannon rather than tear gas. Suppose we talk to them.
Yes.
Suppose we insist on them wearing their masks, then beat them up, then maim them. Would it be a better process?
Afanda Ki, there are some photos that have gone viral today of some soldiers and police officers taking cover with their guns pointed at an advancing group of NOP supporters. I think it was in Mayuge.
I carefully watched. No soldier discharged a live bullet.
No. Okay. Regardless of whether they discharged or not. But that very act of them taking cover as if they were preparing to shoot.
That is
because, you know, in the past we've had instances where citizens have been shot dead by soldiers and police officers. Are we waiting for such an incident to happen?
We are seeing an election for him, is seeing a military expedition.
Are you happy about such things?
I want to go around. That's why it's not a military expedition as such. That's why we have police ahead and we come in and give them support. First of all, I want really not to look at the police as the people or us in security are the ones giving, you know, the ugly face of these elections. Let's sort of take a blame where it is due. And for us, it is very clear. All of the forces, anything that is excessive is punishable. Very clear. Even today, I had my senior colleague Enanga saying that if you have your phone and you capture somebody doing something beyond what he's supposed to do, capture it and action will be taken. For us in UPDF, it has been our norm. It is our culture. You do something beyond what you're supposed to do, we punish you, and we punish you, and the public comes to know that we have punished you. But let's look at these leaders who themselves become the vanguard of violating the law. What do you expect the police to do? We are talking of masks. I have seen very many political leaders.
But
actually, to be very specific,
as you continue, I found a key.
Let me first put this clear.
As you continue,
I have seen leaders who are aspiring to be members of parliament, to be presidents, no mask, with all the kind of crowds around them. If you were in the meeting, where you agreed on the rules and regulations how to run these elections.
Why don't you be the leader to tell your people that please, you do like this.
At least you come out and behave well.
There is a common question in the public domain. Weighing the danger between the two. If you find people who are marching peacefully, and UPDF and police comes and pulls out tear gas and people start scampering, and it even creates accidents, and this tear gas also has health hazards, which is more dangerous? If you left them to march peacefully, and
there,
when
there is no procession, it was a law, a rule agreed in their meeting of stakeholders. There is no gatherings. Have you not seen these people in the usual football ground and everybody is there?
But I told you, even the NRM camp has been having processions.
We have seen
NRM parliamentary candidates here, are having big rallies in their constituencies.
But at least I have witnessed some camps where they are seated in the tents, social distanced. I have seen some areas where people are in a playground, like the usual Kadogi style we used to have. Really, how do you come and blame the police?
No, but you've not answered my question, which is in the public domain, by the way. When you find such a big crowd of people who are peaceful and you throw tear gas canisters in them and fire bullets, they start scampering and knock each other.
This is a dispersion process everywhere. There is actually an argument that you even create more risks of them getting COVID because then they begin to touch their soft parts,
scampering for water.
When you start a problem,
you create another problem, and the problem keeps escalating.
Maybe the tear gas kills the COVID.
But tear gas, standard.
Anyway, let me get your take on that. That concern in the public domain, that what the army and the police are doing is actually creating more problems.
I think it's actually to make sure that the people shouldn't do this. I see what is happening, you don't go there.
I think it's important to understand, because you see the...
Is it possible, as you submit, that the motivation is not actually COVID, but they are hiding under COVID to curtail the civil liberties of the opposition groups?
I'll tell you what is in the public domain, but I wanted to say, to pick it up from the point that even as a police officer, as a military officer, you don't handle all situations the same way. You should be able to make an assessment and understand what kind of measures to take. But it does seem that for them, they have only one response has to be tear gas now. You see, from the layman's point of view, from the civilian point of view, when we see the conduct, the way the security, the men in uniform relate with opposition politicians and the kiddie gloves they use to handle the supporters of the party in power, you can't help but think and believe that maybe these are not necessarily impartial. They already have a side, and they're supporting the side that is in power, and then they're trying to support the whole efforts that are aimed at ensuring that the regime survives. But that said, I think it's important for them to remember that uniform or no uniform, you are Ugandan. We go for elections because we all have a stake in this country and we wish it better. If a civilian who knows nothing, probably acting out of ignorance, does act in a way and manner that violates the COVID, you know, measures, I think the best response is not to use tear gas or go point guns at them. I think at times you may be helped to wait a little bit longer, to hold your horses a little bit longer and see how the situation unfolds. Unfortunately, the uniform response of tear gassing and using all excessive force possible to make sure that the supporters are disbanded, and that happening only to opposition supporters, because you saw what the videos that were making rounds on social media of a certain Bebe Cool, and you know, making the biggest, one of the biggest processions that there was. And you question yourself,
disruption.
Why is it that the state or the men in uniform are present and absent at the same time? They are present and absent at the same time. When there is supporters of the other party in power, they are absent. But should the opposition emerge and do something, they are present. So these are some of the things that I think the citizens would want to see changing, and see how we can pull together.
Either way, sorry, I just want maybe, you know, when for us, some of us who have been staff officers of our bosses, when you give your boss, when there is a task, you sometimes, it's always clever for you to propose a solution. When we are talking of excessive force here, is the use of tear gas more excessive force than using live bullets?
Can I give you information?
We asked for water cannon.
They have the water cannons.
Mm.
It depends on how it is prepared. It can be even worse.
We don't want you to prepare it for the worst.
So
we want you to prepare it
but
for preventive.
Comes with water
for
cannon.
Preventive purposes.
You can start with a megaphone and say, get out of here. Get out of here. That is the first one.
I have seen police officers with the megaphones. I have seen that several occasions with the megaphones. Always the commander is having a megaphone.
And
but you are talking to a group which continues to advance. For us, if it was a military confrontation, just a mere lift of the leg like this,
you should
not take the second leg.
Mm-hmm.
We are, it's okay, at least we are working behind the police, but if it was a real confrontation, it would be really ugly scene. On the other side of, I'm trying as much as possible to avoid to discuss
political candidates.
No, politics, I discuss politics. I'm political.
You're political, everybody.
I'm only non-partisan, but
is,
I'm
is
very
Is UPDF
political.
Partisan? Because there is that concern in the public domain.
No, UPDF is non-partisan.
You are doing everything possible
to
protect President Yoweri Museveni.
Some people use their English wrongly. I vote, I have a right to vote.
And to participate in civil matters.
Therefore, I am political.
Absolutely.
What I am not, I'm non-partisan because I don't belong to any political party.
Mm.
So being a political and being non-partisan, these are two different things.
Mm.
So the public, I have seen even people writing papers, even
we write and
say, UPDF is becoming political, but we are political.
Yeah, you are political.
Yes, but you're not supposed to be partisan.
We have seen some
army officers actually.
Get that person going partisan, take him to courts of law. The rules are very clear.
Don't you have a mechanism as UPDF to handle some of these errant
army
officers who come out and issue political statements? I can give you an example.
There is a rule of law here.
Yes.
I can give you an example.
If somebody has broken the law, take him to court.
No, but UPDF, you should have a mechanism.
The mechanism
to
is
handle
there.
Such errant officers because you have
the
a code of conduct.
The mechanism is there and it is through our court martial, which is part of the legal system. Simple.
Can I give you an example?
Bring
I have seen General Muhoozi, the first son, on many occasions issuing political statements.
Partisan.
Some of them directed at Bobi Wine, and we all know that he's still a serving army officer. And we've never seen you. We've never seen you come out to caution him.
Presidential advisor.
Yes. He has never retired from.
Yes, but I'm saying, I'm trying to show you the degrees of precedence in the army.
Mm-hmm.
A presidential advisor
is above the UPDF code.
No, he's not above the UPDF code. A presidential advisor who has an immediate supervisor and he has an institution where he belongs to. Two. If anybody is aggravated by his statement, raise a complaint. Even in the police, by the way, somebody can break a law I just learned it, that if somebody does not come up and complain against this person who has broken the law,
they will not do anything.
They will not do anything.
Yeah, they must be complaining.
You yourself who is breaking the law and you don't take a step. You yourself.
And Afande, thank you very much, because they always ask, what is the role of civil society? You only make noise. And yet it is civil society that is always complaining on behalf of the citizenry, that these policemen, so and so, we produce names, we produce numbers, we produce details. So the public should also be appreciative of the risky role civil society involves.
Very good. And by the way, there we are on the same note. I worked with civil society organizations against the LRA when we were working in Northern Uganda, and I must credit most of them did a great job, and that's how we managed to win the war collectively.
Well, that's encouraging.
So that it was not, sometime they used to play a role of blaming, but at some point, because of the different sensitizations, we worked together, we partnered. You remember that time we have the retired Brigadier Charles Wacha, a very renowned advocate. And we brought together everybody on board. And this is how the LRA insurgency ended. It was not only ending the bullets. Some of us were
disengaging. I have attended some.
This is
some,
the same thing that we are advocating for here.
I am aware
in
that
this election, the United
Nations human rights have had trainings with you and many other development partners, especially on the use of ammunition in dispersing crowds. And I have also attended some of
just
these trainings.
Just human rights in general.
But one of their concerns, even in the course of training you, they have been cautioning you against the use of bullets in handling civilians, which we have seen actually in the recent days, a lot of live bullets being fired. Can't you handle these situations without bullets? Because in the course of using bullets in the past, many citizens have been shot dead.
Let me tell you. The use of bullets, the way you are describing them, if it is the way they are used, then we would have had a disaster in this country.
No, but in the past, we
because
have had
have
citizens
seen,
who have been shot dead.
We have
by
what,
the,
they,
by UPDF
we have what
officers,
they call
by
isolated incidences, and you have seen how we deal with. Have you heard of this soldier we have sentenced to 90 years?
Yeah, I saw that story.
That is what it means. When an isolated incident happens, we handle you with a very strong arm. In the UPDF, you release a live bullet, it goes to where it's not directed to be, then you are dealt with. Then let me insist on firing. Mm. There is what they call a deterrence firing. I may shoot in the air to not let you come closer to me. I will shoot again. If you continue advancing, I will disable you. It is allowed.
Using bullets?
Are you aware?
Using
yes.
bullets.
I will shoot you in the leg so that you stop advancing towards me, especially in cases of self-defense. So I'm not bringing this into civil matters, but for example, I am armed, I'm having my escorts, I'm moving somewhere, you try to attack me, I will shoot in the air using my live bullet. I will shoot again. If you continue coming, I will disable you. I may not have to kill you, but I will disable you, and the law allows that. Maybe you did not know it.
Actually, I will give an example of the Chebando case where a father was going to slaughter the son, five-year-old son, and the police came and tried to disable the father, but unfortunately the bullet shot his throat.
That
no
person
one,
should be here disabled.
But even
tried,
the UPDF and the police
no
have done such mistakes
beyond
in the past.
What happened, and yet they explained that the act allows them to disable. Unfortunately, the bullet
we don't disable by hitting the head or the neck. The areas of disabling are very clear.
Let me give you an
so
example.
Those ones are explained by the,
let me give you
by
an
the
example.
Trial. During the but, trial, but the courts will determine.
In the course of firing, in the course of firing and scaring away the crowds, we've seen in the past that some young people throw stones. So if a stone hits you, in most cases, of course, you can lose control and you direct it directly at them. And
Now that's where the procedure, the legal procedure, has all of those areas to determine.
Takes precedence.
That's why some people are charged of murder, others are charged of manslaughter. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
But
okay, Charity, I wanted to get your take on the, you know, with all this that is happening, the confrontations and the heavy presence of the soldiers and police officers in these electoral processes, what does it say about the credibility of the 2021 general elections?
Unfortunately, it's not saying a very good picture about the credibility, because one, before we started the election, we knew that everybody has told you it is a civil matter. A civil matter is supposed to be a matter for ordinary citizens, not a matter for police versus ordinary citizens. But that's what we have seen right now. It is like the police is pitted against the ordinary citizens. First, they, the ordinary people in the countryside, they believe they don't have COVID. And I have made this point very clear. For them, they think they are normal. It is us in Kampala who are abnormal or who have our COVID in our heads.
Actually, you are taking COVID to them.
Uh-huh. That's what they think. Now, because they are not yet sensitized to the level of Kampala and the politics of Kampala, the dynamism within Kampala and the way people understand issues is different from the way the people in the countryside understand their issues. For them in the countryside, as long as they can sleep, eat, and whatever, the dynamism there is totally different. The things that affect the way they think about political processes is totally different.
Just as you continue, you've made a very good observation, which I have heard from many other people. When you look at these SOPs,
these people are hiding under, the compliance rate in the countryside, it could even be at less than 2%. These people have been living their normal life. So when Chagulani goes there or Poa, and you are telling them about the SOPs which they have not been complying to, it doesn't make sense to them.
Exactly. So in terms of a civil process, what should happen is continuous explanation. That's why we have what they say, Uganda Human Rights Commission is in charge of civic education. Now, in the civic education package that Uganda Human Rights Commission was supposed to roll out to the public, they were supposed to be teaching them the standard operating procedures to prevent them from COVID and tell them about a disease called COVID. Unfortunately, that has not happened. Now, the Uganda Human Rights Commission was supposed then to ally carefully with the Uganda Electoral Commission and civil society bodies, which would have funding to drum up the whole message to citizens that we are working with a COVID election. What does a COVID election mean? Then you explain to the citizen, a COVID election means you cannot have processions, you cannot have rallies, but you can sit in a room where you're 200 people and you can shift from one level to another, like this or this. But now that that explanation did not happen, it is difficult to blame the ordinary citizen. And now the police should therefore understand and work with this background that those people you are tear gassing have no idea why they are being subjected to this tear gas.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And on that very note, let's go for a brief commercial break. Our dear viewers, don't go away. We shall be coming back. Thank you very much.
It's time.